Hallelujah. All praises to the Elohim, the power of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Long live the King. You know what I'm saying? Honor of his only begotten beloved Son, the Holy Messiah, Yahushua Mashiach, Yahushua, the Messiah of Nazareth. He did currently sitting at the right hand of the heavenly power and soon to return to conquer. Your brother Malachi Maccabee, STL Israelite, Order Mikael's the Dead Camp. Sect of the Nazarenes, Hebrew Israelite Radio Network, and back with another, quick hitter video, and it's all about defending the kingdom. You understand? This is in response to the enemies of the kingdom, call themselves the Torah Knights. You know what I'm saying? I've kind of been listening and watching the Great Falling Away. There's a lot of brothers that claim they messianic. You know what I'm saying? But be listening to these snake oil salesmen, slicker than snake oil, you feel me? And they'll jump into some of these letters and one line to Brother Shaul, who you know is Paul, you know what I'm saying, butchers letters. And then you got those that really ain't convinced and really ain't convinced in the Messiah, you know what I'm saying? And then they be thinking that these characters done tore down the Messiah. And when I say the Messiah, I'm talking about the Messiah written of in that New Testament, you know what I'm saying? Who fulfilled the scriptures, you understand, and walk not only just was flawless and not sinning and not breaking a commandment, but unlocked the power of that Torah. You know what I'm saying? And ain't none of you Negroes is throwing rocks and hiding y'all hands, and that's enemies of the throne of the Messiah. You know what I'm saying? None of y'all came close. It's not even the same sport. It ain't even the same ballpark. It ain't even the same league. You know what I'm saying? Ain't no man since the Messiah touch this earth that has come close to doing the mighty works that he displayed. You know what I'm saying? So this is a response to these characters that call themselves Torah Knights, because those characters are enemies of the gospel when you done talking. You feel me? And without the gospel, without the good news, you understand, Israel is done. It's bad news. Israel is in darkness. You understand? So we're going to clear up some of these misconceptions, because you brothers badly butchered them letters of Shaul or Paul. I seen that attempt to discredit the brother, the unholy opossum Paul, or Paul is deaf. You dig? And a whole bunch of cats was, can I slap up Paul? That's me next. Can I slap up Paul? And if y'all don't understand, Paul was a scholar in the Torah. You feel me? Like Peter and them was unlearned men. The Messiah took unlearned men like Peter and them, the fishermen. And, you know what I'm saying? Men that wasn't raised up in the Torah, like learned. You know what I'm saying? He took unlearned men and raised them up and confounded the learned men. Now, the difference between Shaul, he was much younger than Peter and them, but he was learned. He was raised among the master teachers like Gamaliel and all them. So the level most you so-called Torah scholars are striving to get on, Shaul was that. Before he even met the Messiah on his road to Damascus, you understand? So if that's the case, then the level you striving for, you ain't even there carnally. You ain't even there carnally with that brother before, you know what I'm saying, the mysteries of the Torah was unlocked to him on his road to Damascus. You understand? So what we gonna do today is go over some of these scripts, you know what I'm saying? So a lot of these misconceptions, you know what I'm saying, and put to rest, you know what I'm saying, what people are saying about the brother Shaul, you know what I'm saying, because he's largely and grossly misunderstood. You understand? So we're going to hit this right here, start this off in 2 Peter chapter 3. And what we're going to do today, the bulk of it is going to be Romans chapter 3 and Romans chapter 4. Slowly go through there and critique what these brothers supposedly went through. They was claiming they was going to slap up Paul or whatever, but they did what the Sunday church do. They one-lined the brother. See, on one end, the Sunday church had you thinking, Paul is telling you to be lawless. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got to keep no law. Thus, they come off with the mindset of, I'm saved. I ain't got to keep no law. And what they run to, the letters of Paul. They one-lined, right? The non-messianics, or these characters that call themselves the Torah Knights, they go at Paul, but they go at him to prove that he was a heretic because he's teaching against the commandments of the Most High. That's what both sides is believing. One is saying, "Woo, he freed us," and they call the man Pauline, you know, the Pauline epistles. And for one, that's a woman. I got a big cousin named Pauline. You know what I'm saying? Pauline is a woman. This man's name was Shaul or Paul. You understand? So they call the Christian church, Sunday church, call his letters the Pauline epistles. And the non-messianics or these Torah Knight characters, you know what I'm saying? They going at it because they like, yep, the Christian church right. Like, shit, Paul is saying you ain't got to keep the law. You ain't got to keep the commandments. Look, he's a double-minded man. And these are brothers that just woke up, you know. Like if you wasn't raised a Hebrew, you feel me? Paul was raised a Hebrew. He gave his pedigree in Philippians 3rd chapter. Was raised up in the synagogues and, you know what I'm saying, up in the teachings and in the Hebrew and Torah. He was raised in all that. You know what I'm saying? So this man was a scholar. How in the hell are y'all jumping in the middle of his work and one-lining it and then thinking y'all got a point? You didn't read before. You didn't read after. Did he explain himself? What are you saying? You feel me? So once you are prepped to defend the gospel from the standpoint of it can't be no contradiction, what is this saying, right? And you dig a little deeper, you feel me? Then you're qualified to go ahead and pick up this script and start teaching. But if you like, as soon as you see something on the surface that rattle your frame of thought and you like, oh, I'm exiting stage left. You wasn't ready anyway. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to have in your mind that ain't nothing wrong with the scripture. If something is wrong with what I thought it was saying, then something's wrong with me. Let me get myself together. You feel me? Pray for understanding and seek it. Right? So we're going to start this off in 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter, real quick. 2 Peter chapter 3, 15 and 17. And once again, all praises to the Elohim, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and honor of his only begotten beloved son, Yahushua Mashiach, who's currently sitting at his right hand. Long live the King. This is 2 Peter 3. Verse 15 through 17, it says, "And account that the long suffering of our master is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul or Shaul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, have written unto you, as also in all his epistles," his letters, right? "Speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable wrest or twist, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction." Verse 17, "Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware, lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness." So Peter was saying that some things Paul write is hard to be understood to those that are unlearned and unstable. They twist his writings, and they doing it on both sides, the Sunday church and the non-messianic cats, because they don't really, the non-messianics do it because they don't want to come up under the subjection of the Messiah. So they figure Paul is they out, because they figure Paul is teaching against Torah. You know what I'm saying? And that ain't even the case. That's what the crazy part. If you really sit down and read the brother, you'd be like, somebody's lying, right? And I know a lot of you brothers done combed that Torah, you feel me, and then combed the letters of Paul and the Gospels and all that, you feel me? But there's a lust there to hate the Messiah. See, that's what we're dealing with when you get down to it. There's an Antichrist spirit, a non-messianic, non-anointed spirit that lusts to go against the throne of the Messiah. The Messiah was set up by his Father in the heavens, you feel me? Not what y'all hearing from these characters talking about Joseph, his father. No, the Messiah was set up by his Father in the heavens from the beginning, right? And those that's on the level understand that. You understand? So what we're going to do today is just, you know what I'm saying, them brothers laid a charge. This is court then. Been charged with something, right? Where's your proof of claim? So they going to charge him as an unholy apostle or that he's deaf. We're going to go right through his letters because that's what we got. That's the evidence we got is what he wrote, right? We're going to go right through his letters and see if he defends himself, you know what I'm saying, from these naysayers. And then that way you can read his Bible and be comfortable. Zion, you understand? Because if you take your eyes off the Messiah, you take your eyes off the prize,
and start thinking you can achieve this just because you done threw you a little garment on or something. You sadly mistaken. You sadly mistaken. So we just read 2 Peter 3, right? We're going to jump over here to Acts 24. Acts 24, 14 through 16. Acts 24, 14 through 16. This is Paul or Shaul again. Acts 24:14. I'm gonna start at verse 11. Acts 24:11-16. Because that thou mayest understand that there are yet but 12 days since I went up to Jerusalem for to worship. This is Shaul talking, right? He said, it's been 12 days since I went up to Jerusalem for what? To worship. All right. And they neither found me in the temple disputing with any man, neither raising up the people, neither in the synagogues nor in the city. Neither can they prove the things whereof they now accuse me. That's for them Torahite characters. Y'all can't even prove what y'all talking about, man. I watched that. Me and one of the bros watched that and we laughed like, dang, they gonna straight one line this brother like that. Dang, boy, that's a lust. That's an antichrist spirit lust. You feel me? Because who don't be thorough in their investigation? Remember, your soul is on the line. How you not going to be thorough in your investigation? How you going to leave all this evidence out there? Y'all wouldn't be federal investigators nor prosecutors long. You'd be out of a job quick. You showed up to court and got handled like that. All right? Y'all left so much evidence on the table, man. This right here is verse 14. But this I confess unto thee, that after the way which they call heresy, so worship I the power of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and in the prophets. Ah, so Paul leans on the law and the prophets. He leans on the very Torah that y'all claim y'all knights of. He like, look, I believe everything written in the law and the prophets. Let's keep reading. It says, and have hope toward Yah, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and unjust. So he was saying he believed everything written in the Torah, written in the law and the prophets. And he went a step deeper and was like, yeah, I also believe in the resurrection, because that's witnessed to in the Old Testament, or what you call the Torah. You feel me? That's already witnessed. Daniel 12, 1 through 4. Job speak about the resurrection. I believe that's chapter 29 or something like that. You dig? Also, David himself, Psalms 16th chapter. Last three verses. David is speaking about the resurrection. So what Shaul is talking about ain't something like what you would call a New Testament concept. It's the truth. But notice he said, I believe all things written in the law and the prophets. So we're going to put him on trial and see if he really do. Right? And see, do you really believe all things written in the law and the prophets? Was you thorough in your research? Are you Negroes really scholars? Or are you just putting self-imposed titles on yourself like most of these cats doing? And on top of that, y'all got problems with the One West bunch. But me and my brothers ain't out of One West. You understand? My brothers that even started the Bible study in St. Louis 30 years ago, they ain't out of One West. They wasn't influenced by One West. You know what I'm saying? So you're dealing with a whole nother breed. You know, it ain't even a brag. It's just the truth. You know what I'm saying? We prep to defend the gospel. So whatever you talking, bring it. You know, or stay on over there and talk that, you know, throw that and hide your hands like you already doing. Because y'all know what it is, man. Y'all done held on to these scriptures long enough to understand what's really going on around here, right? So this right here is Acts 28. I'm going to go to Acts 28. Acts 28, 20 through 23. Acts chapter 28, 20 through 23. Acts 28. I believe it is. Acts 28. I'm going to start at verse 20. For this cause, therefore, have I called for you to see you and to speak with you, because that for the hope of Yisrael, I am bound with this chain. This is Paul. He on house arrest at the time. He locked up. You know what I'm saying? But notice he's saying this for the hope of Yisrael. Yasha'al. I'm bound. I'm locked up because I love my people. You know what I'm saying? But it was a war between us, between the Israelites that believed that Yahushua, Yahushua is the Messiah, and those that didn't and were sworn to put us to death. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of you brothers want to play buddy-buddy with these non-messianics, but you can't even do that. You know what I'm saying? Because 2,000 years ago, it would have been a civil war. You know what I'm saying? It would have been a problem. Those were the brothers that was hunting us before the white man was hunting us. Right? And it was all based off of belief. You know what I'm saying? Or a strong faith, a conviction. And what this thing is about. 21. It says, and they said unto him, we neither receive letters out of Judea concerning thee, neither any of the brethren that came showed or spake harm of thee. But we desire to hear of thee what thou thinkest. So they're like, well, look, we want to know what you think. Why? It says, for as concerning this sect, the Nazarene sect. All right. That was the part. That was Paul's sect. Or little clique they was talking about, his group. Sect of the Nazarenes. Why? Because we believe that Yahushua of Nazareth is the Messiah. You understand? So we say, as concerning this sect, we know that every word it is spoken against. Trip off that. Everybody got something to say about the Messianic. Y'all niggas is into Christianity. I done heard it all. Y'all done worship white Jesus. And you know what I'm saying? Done heard it all. But when they come down and say, no, well, look, we ain't even got to go into the New Testament. Let's deal in the old. I got plenty of questions for you brothers. And I pray you got answers. Only with that, what you call the Torah. Because there are many prophecies in that Torah that got to do with Yahushua. And that brothers is ducking. Now, trip off that a couple years ago, y'all was pumping unity. Everybody pumping unity, come together. You dig? But what you think? We ain't finna talk about, what, the big elephant in the room? You think we not finna bring up? Well, at least my brethren, we gonna bring up the Messiah. We don't check him at the door. Like you check your coat or something. You know what I'm saying? He don't get checked at the door. You feel me? It's going to go sideways real quick because questions need to get answered. And if you ain't got it, if you're not qualified to teach, shut down then, man. Shut down. All right? Acts 28, verse 23. And when they had appointed him a day, there came many to him into his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of Yah, persuading them concerning Yahushua, both out of the law of Moshe and out of the prophets, from morning till evening. Trip off that. He proved the Messiah with the Torah, with the law and the prophets. And see how long he was doing it, from morning to the evening time. Up banging, spreading his word, thoroughly convinced. Right? Verse 24, same thing today. It says, and some believed the things which were spoken, and some believe not. And it's the very thing we got going on today. You understand? And also for y'all to think Paul was teaching lawlessness, go to 1 Corinthians 6 real quick. 1 Corinthians 6. And these are letters. These are letters. You know what I'm saying? Expounding on the Torah. Remember, this man was a Torah scholar. And we're going to get that to his pedigree. And also, Negro was trying to say Paul was an Edomite. I'm like, boy, these boys are unlearned, man. How many times Paul go on record and say he an Israelite out the tribe of Benjamin? How many times? And y'all tripping off brothers that got pagan names in the New Testament? Yeah, like you niggas got Smith on your back. Or Johnson on your back. Somebody hear my name 100 years from now, ain't got no image of me. Guess what? They gonna think what? He was a white man. So you can't trip off, you know what I'm saying, colonization. That's what this white man do. Change your name up and do all that. You know what I'm saying? So now you reading letters and say, well, who is Mark and who is John? You don't want to get all, you know, like John. Those sound like white people. But on your driver's license, it says Marquis Smith. Huh? But you a Hebrew now, right? So just because you got your slave master's last name or even some of your forefathers adopted the cultures of your masters don't mean that you are that. You feel me? It's just that culture was adopted. All right, so 1 Corinthians 6, real quick. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9 through 11, right? It says, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of Yah? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of the Most High. So all those are lawbreakers. Notice he said, be not deceived. None of these are getting in. If you want to know the definition of all that, you got to go back to the law to find it. Right? So what was the brother really saying when he was going to certain scriptures saying you ain't up under the law, you under grace? Like, what does that mean? I'm free to sin? What does he mean? Or is he saying what? A new administration is taking over. You understand? You're no longer up under the order of Aaron or the government of Aaron or the government of Moses. Another administration is taking over. Right? There's another priest. There's a higher priesthood, a higher temple. You feel me? That we are governed by. Order Melchizedek, the priesthood of the heavens. Right? Abraham, our father, was under that too because he was up under a priesthood before Moshe got it on Mount Sinai, before Aaron got it. Right? But Genesis 14, he paid tithes to Melchizedek. You understand? So there was a priesthood already in the earth. And brothers and sisters, for y'all don't know, that's the priesthood you're under. You're not under the command of none of these Negroes running around here today. Especially, he brothers calling themselves generals. Boy, that boy, I get a good laugh every time I hear that. Every time I hear that, I get a good laugh. Because it can't be substantiated with the gospel. Oh, yeah, brothers. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, there's different positions in the body. Play your position. Play your part. But nonetheless, ain't no ruling over the brothers. You got that twisted. I don't know what's wrong with these characters. So let's get this started, man. Let's go to Romans, the second chapter, the end of Romans chapter 2, and we're going to read in chapter 3. This is just real quick, and I'm addressing these guys that call themselves the Torah Knights, right? Y'all need to go back to the drawing board with that lesson. Anybody that studied up would have picked that apart. I know we did seconds. Like, we sat there and listened, and as soon as y'all made a point, pause that. Play it again. Make another point. Pause that. 3-4 scriptures right out the Torah. I'm talking about destroying your whole foundation, man. So this is just, you know, words of encouragement and exhortation. Don't fall for that non-anointed antichrist spirit because it will get you killed, man. You feel me? These brothers ain't went through all this hell and high water so you can have a scripture today tell you that you ain't getting to the Father unless you go through the Son. Tell you there are many antichrists who confess not that the Messiah has come in the flesh. Right? This is a deceiver. Messiah ain't said you're going to die in your sins if you don't believe. He ain't said all that for nothing. You feel me? But see, it conveniently, because you're praying he ain't real. So if he ain't real, then guess what? That means you're not up under his subjection. So guess what? That means I ain't got to pay attention to what they call the New Testament at all. But see, just like our people got that complex to where they think they can not trip off something or deny something and it's going to go away. That ain't the truth, man. Y'all going to have to deal. Let's deal. Romans chapter 2, I'm going to start at verse 21. We're going to read 21 through 24 and then get some Isaiah to back it up, right? Romans chapter 2, verse 21. Thou therefore which teacheth another, teachest thou not thyself? That's a question. Like, we out here teaching. We out here instructing people, telling them to turn from their wickedness, turn from what they're doing. Naturally, you would be checking yourself, right? Like, I know you ain't telling folks not to be an adulterer, and you are an adulterer. Huh? I know you ain't out here teaching folks not to steal, and you got the 5-finger discount yourself. See, so what was Shaul addressing? The hypocrisy of these outer cup Hebrews who were thinking just because they had a garment and some fringes and some phylacteries and was circumcised and seeds of Abraham that they was guaranteed the kingdom. The brother was saying, man, look, y'all got a whole nother thing coming, man. A whole nother thing coming. If you think that's sufficient to get into the kingdom. Huh? Obviously, brothers was teaching others, but wasn't teaching themselves. So guess what? Hypocrisy is at an all-time high. How you teaching, but you ain't teaching yourself? How you checking, but you not checking yourself? How you correcting the world, but you ain't correcting your house? It don't make sense, right? So we say, thou that preach of a man should not steal, dost thou steal? Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhors idols, dost thou commit sacrilege, or do you rob temples? Huh? I thought idols were an abomination, but for some money, you go rob a pagan temple for the silver and the gold. Hypocrisy, right? And it says, thou that makest thy boast of the law through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? You boast yourself in the law and the Torah, but all y'all are transgressors of it. Hmm? Is that not dishonoring the Most High? Trip off this. Verse 24, for the name of the Most High is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. So, is Shaul making that up? He said the name of the Most High is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. So is he lying on that? Is that written somewhere? That the name of the Most High is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you? Like, because you went off and turned your back on the Most High, you got the Gentiles ruling over you, and the Most High's name is blasphemed. Trip off that. Well, let's read Isaiah 52. Let's go there. So was the brother lying when he said that? Let's see. Isaiah the 52nd chapter. Isaiah 52. Isaiah 52. These brothers want to discredit the brother, but he's quoting Torah the whole way through. That's what he's doing. He's quoting the Torah, proving the belief and faith in the Messiah. All right, Isaiah 52. I'm going to read 1 through 5. It says, awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. So that means you sleep. If you got to awake, that means at one point you sleep. Put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Yerushalayim, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come into thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. Verse 2. Shake thyself from the dust. Arise and sit down, O Yerushalayim. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck, O captive daughter of Zion. O captive daughter of Zion. So you see that Jerusalem, the city, and the people are one and the same. Okay, for thus saith Yahweh, you have sold yourselves for naught. You have sold yourselves for naught, and ye shall be redeemed without money. You sold yourselves for nothing. You picked up the worship of another God. It is your fault in the end, or our fault in the end, that we up in captivity. Yeah, the heathen that went overboard. Yeah, he done broke every treaty. But why are we hurt? What happened with you? How was you able to be taken down as Yisrael or Yasha'ala? How was you able to be taken down? What happened? Trip off that. What ended up happening? It says, for thus saith the Most High, ye have sold yourselves for nothing, but you're going to be redeemed without money. Wow. Verse 4. For thus saith the Most High power, my people went down aforetime into Egypt to sojourn there. And the Assyrian oppressed them without cause. We were slaves to the Egyptians and the Assyrian. But it's because you sold yourself for nothing. Huh? You were the reason why you went into captivity. Trip off that. Verse 5. Now, therefore, what have I heard, saith the Most High, that my people was taken away for naught? Remember, you sold yourselves for nothing. My people was taken away for naught. They that rule over them make them to howl, saith the Most High. And my name continually every day is blasphemed. So was the brother Shaul lying when he said that? The name of the Most High is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, because you were the ones that sold yourselves for naught. Right? And every time we go against the Most High, we give a green light for the oppressor. Come right on in and oppress. You look up and the Most High name will be blasphemed. Now, how you got the sons and daughters of the living power, right? We supposed to be a light to the Gentiles, but the Most High's name is being blasphemed amongst the Gentiles because of us. So what was Shaul dealing with? He was dealing with the hypocrisy of these outer cup Israelites. And he was using the Torah to prove his point. All right? Romans 2, verse 25. It says, for circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law. So your circumcision will profit and do good for you if you keep the law, right? But if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. If you are a breaker of the transgressor of the Torah, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. Who understand that? Who understand that? Your circumcision has become uncircumcision. We got biblical examples, don't we? First Maccabees chapter 1, 11 through 15, where it says our people became uncircumcised. When they forsook the covenant of the Most High and made a covenant with the heathen is when we became uncircumcised. Right. So that don't mean foreskin grew back on our member. That means we became uncircumcised. So circumcision is in the mind first before it ever got outside. It's in the mind. It goes into the righteousness of the law, which is the faith, the belief. You feel me? Because you could be doing something, but not believe it, not really believe what you're doing. You know what I'm saying? So it go into that. So we become uncircumcised when we start dealing or acting like these heathens. So Shaul saying your circumcision profit, you Israelite, it'll profit if you keep the Torah. But if you a breaker of it, what good is your circumcision? What good is your baptism? What good is your fringe wearing if you are a transgressor of the Torah? If you a transgressor of it, what good is all the outer cup signs you over here trying to boast in? What good is it? Makes sense, don't it? Also, we asked the first Maccabees 1, right? 11 through 15. We're going to do 2 Kings. We're going to do 2 Kings 17, 14 through 15, just real quick. 2 Kings. Y'all read that first Maccabees 1 Maccabees 1, 11 through 15 on the uncircumcision. All right? This right here is 2 Kings chapter 17. 2 Kings chapter 17, right? Verse 14 through 15. 2 Kings chapter 17. So the brother was using the Torah to prove his point. And that's what most folks don't realize. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people don't really want to go into what it really was being said, because their whole curriculum comes tumbling down. 2 Kings 17 verse 14. Notwithstanding, I'm going to start at 13. Start at 12. For they served idols, whereof Yahweh had said unto them, ye shall not do this thing. Yet Yahweh testified against Israel and against Yehuda by all the prophets and by all the seers saying, turn ye from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes according to all the law which I commanded your fathers and which I sent to you by my servants the prophets. Notwithstanding, when it says turn from your evil ways, it means repent, put down all this wickedness, right? Like you in the midst of doing now with this hella day season, right? Verse 14, notwithstanding they would not hear, but hardened their necks like to the neck of their fathers that did not believe in the Most High of their power. So they did not believe. They did not have faith. They got hard hearted. Right. They're uncircumcised at this point. 15. And they rejected his statutes and his covenant that he made with their fathers and his testimonies, which he testified against them. And they followed vanity and became vain and went after the heathen that were round about them, concerning whom Yahweh had charged them that they should not do like them. And they left all the commandments of the Most High of their power and made them molten images, even two calves, and made a grove and worshiped all the hosts of heaven and served Baal. You see that? So Israel didn't want nothing to do with the Most High. It say they rejected his statutes and his covenant that he made with their fathers and his testimonies, which he testified against them. And they followed vanity and became vain and went after the heathen that were round about them. So wanted to be just like the heathen. See that? That makes us uncircumcised. So the first Maccabees 1. Matter of fact, let me grab that real quick. First Maccabees chapter 1. Verse 11. It says, in those days went there out of Israel wicked men. What kind of men? Wicked men. Who persuaded many, saying, let us go and make a covenant with the heathen that are round about us. For since we departed from them, we have had much sorrow. Trip off that. Let us make a covenant with the heathen that are round about us. We just read that in 2 Kings 17. We went after the heathen, followed vanity, and became vain. Let's prove this uncircumcised is someone that's already circumcised. To prove the brother Shaul wasn't lying. Trip off that. It says, so this device pleased them well. Then certain of the people were so forward herein that they went to the king, who gave them license to do after the ordinances of the heathen. Whereupon they built a place of exercise at Jerusalem according to the customs of the heathen, and made themselves uncircumcised. That don't mean a flesh grew back on his member. That mean what? They forsook the covenant of the Most High and start serving other gods. Thus, it made them the uncircumcision, made them uncircumcised, and made themselves uncircumcised and forsook the holy covenant and joined themselves to the heathen and were sold to do mischief. That's the Apocrypha, King James Version. I'm part of the 1611 King James Bible. You understand? But what we just read and what we just find out is that Israel becomes uncircumcised when they forsake the covenant of the Most High and start acting like the nations. They become the uncircumcised, even though physically he may be circumcised. But spiritually, what is he? He's a heathen. Look at how he's acting. All right. Most of our people call themselves Gentiles, and spiritually and mentally, they right. They right. It's just physically they're not Gentiles. But they've taken on a Gentile way of life, customs, their gods, you know. As soon as you talk bad about white folk or anything, white Jesus, boy, a Negro be ready to fight you. He be up in arms. You understand? So let's get back to this. This is Romans 2 right here. Romans 2. So we see your circumcision profit if you keep the Torah. But if you a transgressor of the Torah, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. We just read that. That's biblically. So Paul, Shaul was already justified in what he's saying, the first couple points, because we go right into the Torah to prove what he's saying. So he, this proves that he ain't on the whim with it, he's not winging it, and he ain't talking out the side of his neck. He's using the Torah to prove his stance and his belief, his faith. What he's believing and what he was teaching, he used the Torah to substantiate that. Right? And when you're dealing with stuff like this, you can't one line the brother, you got to read the whole matter. Any topic that's on the table, man, stop leaving scriptures off the table. Bring all the scriptures and put them on the table so we can take off what is impossible and deal with the meat so we can arrive at a righteous judgment. You understand? I see it's so many people scripture shaving and scripture ducking. It's ridiculous. Amongst Israel, too, scripture ducking, man. You'd be like, man, go sit down somewhere with all that, man. How you going to talk this but don't bring all the scriptures on the table? You feel me? You only bring the ones that fit your curriculum. But, I mean, it don't matter because the scriptures are still sitting there. They're not going nowhere. Just because you don't like it don't mean that it's not true. So we can't, you know, defend our emotions. We got to defend the script, man. We got to defend the scripture, not our emotions. We wasn't called to defend our emotions. Defend the scripture. Take yourself up out of it and we'll be better. Right? So right here is Romans, the second chapter. Romans chapter 2, verse 26. Therefore, if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness of the law, which is the faith, the unwavering faith and belief, all right? If they keep the righteousness of the law, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? Trip off that. Like, he's uncircumcised, but he believes he's doing what he's supposed to be doing. Like, if you circumcise, right, but you're a transgressor of the Torah, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. So why wouldn't it be the same opposite? If he's uncircumcised but keeps the righteousness of the Torah, you feel me? His moral, the moral compass of the Torah, you understand? The moral compass of it. If he keeps that, shall not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? You don't want to deal with that, but you know, hell no, no, no. See, you're overzealous. You just fell on your sword. What you mean, no? So you telling me there's no examples of any of our forefathers being uncircumcised and still was righteous? See? You done left things out there. You done left evidence all out there. Left evidence on the table, but didn't bring it into the case. You feel me? Willful suppression of evidence is a felony. I don't know what life y'all living in. But you take that to court and you willfully suppressed evidence? Huh? Oh, that's a felony. That's a major crime. That's a major crime. You can't be suppressing evidence. But that's what y'all doing when y'all start scripture shaving and leaving scriptures off. When you start leaving scriptures off the topic and the dialogue, that's what happens. All right? So verse 28, it says, verse 27. And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision does transgress the law? So if somebody that's uncircumcised see you acting out of order and out of box, right? But you are out of cup with it, garment, circumcision, fringes hanging, but you're acting like a heathen. Shall not one that is uncircumcised, but in the spirit he's keeping the righteousness of the Torah, which is the faith. Like Abraham, he had faith even before he was circumcised, and he was deemed righteous. Shall not someone in that spirit judge you or correct you? Like, man, you way out of order. Boy, that'd be something. Boy, some Gentile roll up speaking in his tongue or whatever. You a Hebrew, you talking about you gonna be my servant in the kingdom. He didn't caught you stanky legging. Caught you out doing something you wasn't supposed to be doing. And he slide right on up, cameras rolling, and correct you. Ooh, hey. Boy, I wonder what you mumble mouth Negro was gonna be saying then. No, see, man, you Arab, man. You can't be telling me nothing about my Bible. But he just caught you out of order and out of box. You know what I'm saying? You was making your boast, but you out of order with it. You know what I'm saying? Caught you slipping, right? And then came and corrected you in front of everybody. Like, hey, that was off, player. Ooh-wee. Okay? Verse 28. For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly. Neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. Uh-oh, see? Now y'all like, see? Now he going left field. He's saying, you not no Israelite or one of the Most High's chosen, right? Because you're circumcised. Hard pill to swallow, huh? What you mean they got circumcised the eighth day? What you mean? Man, there's going to be plenty of circumcised eighth day Negroes roasting in the lake for eternity. What you talking about? He say right here, he say, for he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, in the spirit, right? And circumcision is that of the heart and the mind, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of the Most High. What is he talking about? He was saying you can be circumcised physically, but still act like a heathen spiritually. Right. So that means you ain't been circumcised. Your mind ain't been transformed. You ain't been born again. Right. What good is this outer cup sign that you got going on? And on top of that, can we substantiate that with the Torah? Oh, we can substantiate that with the Torah. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 10. Now, need to say you ain't a Jew or Israelite because you went out with me. Right. Neither is that circumcision, which is that in the flesh. So he basically let you know circumcision ain't just fleshly, it's spiritual. And what circumcises you is your belief, your faith, your strong conviction in the truth. You know what I'm saying? Deuteronomy chapter 10, I'm going to read verse 15 through 17. It said, only Yahweh had a delight in your fathers to love them, and he chose their seed after them, even you above all people, as it is this day, talking to our forefathers. Who are descendants of Abraham, right? Chose you, right? Trip off this. Verse 16. Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. Said you the chosen people, right? You're going to be the Most High's priest, his mouthpiece, right? First step he says, circumcise the foreskin of your heart, though. Stop being hard-headed and rebellious. You say circumcise your rod, not telling you don't circumcise your sons, right? But what good is that? Let's deal with the topic on the table. He's saying don't circumcise. He's saying what is good? What good is that if you're uncircumcised in your spirit, you have no belief? You think that's going to save you just because you got circumcised? You have no belief? That's what he's going into right here, right? So the scriptures say, Torah, Deuteronomy 10, we still in the Torah, right? Y'all brothers believe Deuteronomy is an inspired book, right? Well, Deuteronomy 10, verse 15 through 7, I'm going to read 16 again. Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. For Yahweh your El is a power of gods and Lord of lords, a great power, a mighty, and a terrible. which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. I mean, you can't pay him off. Once his judgment hit, it hit. So he just said, look, you my chosen, but circumcise the foreskin of your heart. Same thing that Shaul or Paul was saying. Circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praises are the Most High, not of man. I understand. So it made sense. He substantiated because the Most High gave the command. Circumcise the foreskin of your heart and don't be stiff-necked. Shaul in Romans, the second chapter, saying the same thing. That ain't a New Testament concept. That's Torah. Circumcise the foreskin of your heart. Let's go to Jeremiah 9 and show you why. Jeremiah 9, I'm going to start at verse 23. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 9, verse 25. I'm going to read verse 25 and 26. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will punish all them which are circumcised with the uncircumcised. Trip off that. Egypt and Judah. Uncircumcised and circumcised. And Edom and the children of Ammon and Moab. And all that are in the utmost corners that dwell in the wilderness. For all these nations are uncircumcised. And all the house of Israel are uncircumcised in the heart. Trip off that. So when he was like, you ain't an Israelite because you went outwardly. Circumcision is that in the heart, in the spirit, right? So Israel physically was circumcised, but in the heart, in the mind, in the mentals, it was hell-bent to go against their power who commanded them to be circumcised. So they got the circumcision, but didn't have a faith, didn't have belief. You know what I'm saying? And got into a lazy mode of thinking, well, I'm circumcised. I got to go on my own. I got phylacteries on. Surely I'm going to be accepted. I descend from Abraham. Surely I'm going to be accepted. And the brother Shaul was like, man, y'all got another thing coming. If you think that's what it's going to be to get into the kingdom, you got to believe first before you start working. You got to have faith first before you start working. If you want to be justified, you can't work your way to belief. You got to believe it first. Faith come by hearing. You got to hear it and be like, man, that makes sense. The light turn on. And then from that point, you ready to work. You know what I'm saying? The problem is you got these brothers that's trying to work their way to faith. You can't do that. You can't work your way to faith. Faith is not nothing that you work off. You know what I'm saying? It's something given. It's a gift. It's not a loan. You get a loan and you got to work. You got to work because you owe that. You go to work because you owe bills. That's debt. But salvation and faith and being justified, all these are gifts given by the Most High. Not because you didn't work and did something. It's a gift. It's through grace. It's a free gift because he wanted to do it. Now, knowing that, now you're ready to work. Now, whatever he tell you, whatever he commands you to do, Abraham, offer up your son. Got you. Didn't bat an eye. Abraham, go over and do this. Didn't bat an eye. You feel me? So we got to get about that mindset, thinking that just because you are Israelite, you guaranteed to get the kingdom. Shaul was going into what the Messiah was teaching. You got to be born again or born from above, a transformation of mind to live the rest of your life according to the Heavenly Father and not according to the will of man. It's just a mind transformation or a circumcision of the heart. You feel me? Because of your righteousness of faith, your true belief. That's what that is. Without that, you can't please the Most High. You got faith. Faith without works is dead, of course. But you got to get the faith first before you start working. You can't work your way to faith. And that was the problem. Everybody was backwards. All right. That was Jeremiah 9. I want to do another one, too. Deuteronomy. Let me do Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6, 5 through 6. That's another one. Deuteronomy 6, 5 through 6. And this words of encouragement, man. Don't be scared of this entire Bible. The whole Bible. I was talking to an elder the other day, man. Straight told me the scripture tampered with. You feel me? I'd be like, man, look, I don't know. You need to scratch holy off your Bible then. Like, I don't understand how do carnal men arrive at a conclusion that the Bible is tampered with. Why you not tampered with? What I was thinking must be wrong. Let me dive deeper into this. Why the script got to be tampered with? You understand? How is you trying to convince anybody to get about the streets or pick the Bible up? But hey, it got tamperings in it, though. Pick this up and read it, but no, I know it say holy, but it's not holy. How are you going to convince anybody to turn their life around if you don't believe in what you bring in them? Stop it, man. Stop all that. Deuteronomy 6, 5 through 6. It says, and thou shalt love Yahweh thy power with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. See, love him with all your who? Your heart. That goes into your mindset, right? And it says, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. See, in your mind. Circumcise your mind. Let's do Jeremiah 4, too. That's a good one. Jeremiah 4. And then we're going to get back to the Romans. Show where the brother Shaul was coming from. You know what I'm saying? And it's crazy because the attack that come on him is coming because folks really hate the Messiah. See, Shaul wrote over 14 letters on what they call the New Testament. Again, he was a learned brother, learning the Torah. Once the Messiah was revealed to him, he went right back through that Torah. I'm like, yep. Basically, the Torah became unlocked to him at that point. And he saw the marvelous light. You understand? So instead of calling him a sellout or a white boy, you know what I'm saying, or that he teaches death, how about y'all brothers finish reading this brother first? You understand? Because had we been in court, the charge you leveled in court, oh man, we came in with a counterclaim and crushed all that. All that. And you'd have been out of a job because I don't know nobody. You wouldn't have been no county prosecutor. The county ain't finna hire you. Hire you knowing that you, I mean, how you investigate and prepare your case. You leave all this evidence. You suppressing evidence. Man, I ain't finna hire you niggas, man. Impossible. Y'all done left too much stuff off the table. All because you want to convict this man and send him away. You understand? So let's get some understanding, right? It's Jeremiah 4. Jeremiah 4, I'm going to read 1 through 4. If thou will return, O Israel, say of Yahweh, return unto me. And if thou will put away thine abominations out of my sight, then shalt thou not remove. And thou shalt swear, Yahweh liveth in truth, in judgment, and in righteousness. And the nations shall bless themselves in him, and in him shall they glory. For thus saith Yahweh to the men of Yehuda, Yahawadah, and Yerushalayim, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. 4. Circumcise yourselves to the Most High, and take away the foreskins of your heart. Ye men of Yahawadah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my fury come forth like fire, and burn that none can quench it because of the evil of your doings. You see that? It got to do with, you got to circumcise the foreskin of your heart. You feel me? The foreskin of your member means nothing if you ain't got it up here. You got to be up here first. You already got to be up here born again. You know what I'm saying? Already a new creature, ready to roll. Dig? If you don't get it here first, this won't profit you. It'll never profit you. You know what I'm saying? Because you be thinking something that you got on outer cup wise will justify you for being in the kingdom. But it's going to be many brothers. It's going to be many brothers that got circumcised on the eighth day and wore garments. They're going to be roasting for eternity because they didn't circumcise their heart. They didn't come up under subjection of the Messiah. Let's get back to this Romans, though. Let's get back to this Romans. So we prove with the Torah that circumcision of the heart is not a New Testament concept. Circumcision of the heart means faith or strong conviction, belief. All right? So that's not a New Testament concept. It's actually out the Torah. Circumcise the foreskin of your heart. Your circumcision profit if you keep Torah, but if you a transgressor of the Torah, your circumcision is uncircumcision. We read that 1 Maccabees 1:11, an actual event that happened. Where it say in the scripture that what? They became uncircumcised because they forsook the covenant of the Most High. So circumcision is spiritual before it can ever get physical. Right. And as we keep reading, Brother Shaul going to lay it all on the line. We're going to stay in the Torah to prove, you know what I'm saying, his position and what he's saying. And then at the end of that, you can, you know, come to your conclusion and say, oh, man, that's a lie. Damn lie. You know what I'm saying? But write down all these Torah scriptures we're going to go to and then read them and say and ask yourself, dang, it do say that. Dang, I was ready to hang this man and call him death, and y'all need to get away from that New Testament. And then, nigga, it's fake. It's fairy tale. It's a Roman invention. I done heard all that. I done heard all that. But we're going to go right through the brother's letters and let him do his second witnessing and referencing with the Torah. And go into the Torah and say, well, dang, it do say that. So somebody been lying. So now you understand somebody been lying. What's the agenda? Got to be an agenda. Right? Either they didn't know they was lying, and they just jumped on the bandwagon because they thought a man was learned that brought them that, or they knew they was lying. You feel me? And intentionally hid and suppressed this, you know what I'm saying, for the hope that you'll stay in darkness with them. Either way is a problem. All right? Either way is a problem. All right, let's get on back here. We in Romans, right? We in Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, we're going to read 1 through 4 first. Romans chapter 3, verse 1. It says, what advantage then have the Jew of circumcision? If you ain't a Jew because you won outwardly, but only inwardly, the question comes up naturally. Well, what advantage then have the Jew? Right? What advantage then have the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Because naturally, you're going to start thinking, well, he's saying that you ain't got to get circumcised. What advantage do you people have if you ain't won, if you won outwardly, you won inwardly, right? And that ain't even real circumcision. So then the natural question has to come up behind that. Well, then what advantage then in it, right? Romans 3, what advantage then have the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Verse 2, much every way. So let's show you he wasn't even dissing the circumcision. He just was like, it don't mean nothing if y'all ain't got it here. It don't even mean nothing if you ain't got the spiritual circumcision, the full faith and belief in the truth. It don't matter. So he just said circumcision much in every way. What advantage have the Jew, or what profit is in circumcision? He didn't say, oh man, niggas done away with, man. Don't matter. He came out and said much in every way. So don't start thinking that the brother is saying that the Most High's people is done away with, or that what the Most High promised he ain't going to do. He ain't saying that. It just was a self-check. Like, how are you telling the world this, but you doing this? That's hypocrisy. That means you're not circumcising the spirit. Huh? You circumcising the flesh, but not in the spirit, and thinking your hypocritical actions gonna be overlooked and you're gonna ice skate into the kingdom. You're gonna step in the name of love into the kingdom. And he let you know, man, you got a whole nother thing coming if you think that's what this thing is about. But notice he said, much in every way is an advantage to be a Hebrew. Much every way, because that unto them were committed the oracles of Yah. Never forget that the oracles, the laws, the word of the Heavenly Father was given to us. That's an advantage in every way. Trip up this. 3. For what if some did not believe? For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of the Most High without effect? Just because you don't believe the truth, does it make it not the truth? In layman's terms. I don't believe. Even if you amongst us and you don't believe that Yahushua, Yahusha is the Messiah. Right? What if some of them, what if some didn't believe? We talking about the Jews, our people. What if some didn't believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of Yah without effect? Just because you don't believe it, do it mean it's not true? Just because you don't believe it, do it mean it's not coming to pass? For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of Yah without effect? Verse 4, Yah forbid. Yea, let the Most High be true, but every man a liar. Trip off that. As it is written, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and mightest overcome when thou art judged. So he say it's written somewhere, right? It's written. As it is written. Let's go to where as it is written. See, he quoting Torah. Just because you don't believe the truth don't mean it ain't going to happen. God forbid, let the Most High be true, but every man a liar, as it is written. As it is written, let's go to where it's written. Psalms 51. Psalms 51. Oh, just about. We're coming right back there. Psalms 51. As it is written, huh? As it is written. So he ain't telling, he ain't dissing his people, saying his people done away with. He ain't even dissing circumcision. He's saying it don't mean nothing if you ain't spiritually the real. If you don't got the real circumcision, it don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing. You're going to be roasting too, right next to the Klansmen. Unless you get the true circumcision, which is the belief and faith in the Son of the Living Power. Believe that. All right? Psalms 51. Psalms 51. Verse 1. Have mercy upon me, O Yah, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgression. Strip off that. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, the only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. Huh? Who are you talking about? Talking about the Most High. That's why he say, as it is written, let God be true, but every man a liar. You feel me? David was saying the same thing. Have mercy on me, Most High. Have mercy on me. You know what I'm saying? He pleading to be forgiven. And that's another thing. Was David, the crime that David did, why wouldn't he put to death? Why was he forgiven? Why was his iniquity pardoned? Even though something he had to pay for it, right? But why was his iniquity pardoned? Was there some work he did? Work. Him and Bathsheba should have been dead. Why? That was adultery. Hmm? She didn't cry out in the city or none of that, or in the field, none of that. She was with it too. Should have been whacked. But why wasn't he killed? Right? And then on top of that, why did the Lord forgive him? Why did the Lord decide to have mercy on him? Was it for work or was it a gift the Lord gave him? Huh? It wasn't nothing. David didn't. It was no work that David did to get his iniquity pardoned. It wasn't no work, right? He cried out to the Most High, but the Most High still can decide to lay you down or show you some mercy. Now, if he's showing you mercy, is it because of some work you did? That's when Paul going to not of works, lest man should boast. Yeah, you would boast if it was something you did that got you justified. But if it ain't nothing that you did, and you know good as well, you should be dead. Oh, no, nah, you ain't finna be boasting. You gonna be humble as a mug, like, man, I should be dead. The law say I should be dead. Why ain't I dead? Huh? Because there was a free gift of grace and salvation given to you. You feel me? Now, from that point, when you got that, you feel me? You walk like a brother that just got let off death row. Thankful. You don't go back out into the street and start murdering. You thankful because you know it's nothing you did that got you pardoned. You know, there was no work you did that got you pardoned. You understand? It was a free gift. And that's the point. And even David is asking for it. Right here, read that Psalm 50, that verse again. Psalms 51, verse 4. Against thee, the only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou, that you might be justified when you speak and be clear when you judge. Right? Because the Most High is the ultimate judge. Like I say, as it is written, that you may be justified in your sayings. You might overcome when you're being judged. You understand? So look, let's go on back to this Romans. Let's go on back to this Romans chapter 3. I'm in verse 5. So Shaul been quoting Torah the whole time we find it out here. Torah the whole time. The Old Testament. All right, Romans 3 verse 5. But if our unrighteousness commend the righteousness of the Most High, what shall we say? Is the Most High unrighteous who taketh vengeance? I speak as a man. God forbid. For then how shall the Most High judge the world? Right. Like, wickedness can't establish righteousness. And if that's the case, then how is there going to be a judgment day? That's his question. Like, well, wickedness can't establish righteousness, because then how would the Lord bring everything into judgment if that's the case? Just like y'all was trying to justify Thanksgiving yesterday or the day before, whenever that was, and you trying to justify Black Friday and then all your little pagan days in your way. Wicked, look, if the origin of it was evil and wicked, nothing, like, it don't matter just because you don't believe that's the origin or meaning of it. You understand? Wickedness can't establish righteousness. So it can't start off wicked and then you think it's going to be righteous because years down the line, you don't believe that's what it was. It don't work like that, right? They said, it says right here, But verse 7, for if the truth of the Most High have more abound through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? If the truth is magnified through a lie I've been putting out, you understand, then how in the world will I be judged as a sinner? Verse 8, and not rather as we be slanderously reported, and as some affirm that we say, let us do evil that good may come, whose damnation is just. Let us do, they act like we saying be evil, or that Shaul was saying be evil so good can come. I get to all kick it. Do whatever you want to do. He said that was a slander. He said they judgment or they damnation to be just, you know what I'm saying? Because you're slandering. You feel me? You putting a free case on brothers, and that ain't even what it is. And trip off that, you ain't even read or researched the whole matter. We arriving at conclusions and ain't even putting no thorough investigation or no research down. We're not even doing that. You understand? Trip off this right here. It says, verse 9, what then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. So now he's back in the Torah again. So he said, everybody's under sin, right? And he said, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after the Most High. They are all gone out of the way. They are become unprofitable. Right here. Let's read Psalms 53, 1 through 4. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. So is he making that up? Is he making that up? Is he talking out the side of his neck? Or is that something that's in the Torah? Let's see. Psalms 53, 1 through 4. So far, this man is proving his position with this Torah. With this your Torah night, right? Well, he proving his position with the Torah. Psalms 53, is this considered inspired? Let's see. Psalm 53, I'm going to read 1 through 4. It says, the fool have said in his heart, there is no power, there is no God. Corrupt are they, and have done abominable iniquity. There is none that doeth good. The Most High looked down from heaven upon the children of men. So all us, the children of men, to see if there were any that did understand, that did seek the Most High. Every one of them is going back. They are all together become filthy. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. So when Shaul writing a letter to the Israelites that's in Rome, he's quoting Psalms 53, a Psalm of David. Psalms 14 is a second witness to it as well. So when he's saying, look, man, the whole world is under sin. Huh? We ain't no better than nobody. The whole world is under sin. As it is written, there is none that doeth good. No, not one. So it's Shaul lying. Let's get back to Romans. Let's get back to this Romans. Romans 3. I'm going to start at verse 13. Romans 3 and 13. Right? It says, their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips. Let's go see if that's written somewhere. Let's go ahead. Let's jump on over here to Psalms 5 and 9. I need Psalms 5 and 9 real quick. The book of Psalms, chapter 5. I need Psalms 5 and 9 and Psalms 140 and 3. Easy work, man. Easy work. That's a shame, man. You know what I'm saying? People lust to hate the Messiah so bad, they, you know what I'm saying, they'll willfully suppress all these scriptures. Psalms 5, number 8 and 9. Lead me, O Yah, in thy righteousness because of mine enemies. Make thy way straight before my face, for there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulchre. They flatter with their tongue. Destroy thou them, O Yah. Let them fall by their own counsels. Cast them out in the multitude of their transgressions, for they have rebelled against thee. You see that? Then give me Psalms 140 and 3. Psalms 140, we read about the poison of asp, right? So Psalms 5 and 9, it says their throat is an open sepulcher. There ain't no faithfulness in their mouth. The inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher, open grave. They flatter with their lips. And David was asking the Most High to destroy them. And a lot of these Psalms, some of them he was talking about his own people as well. You know what I'm saying? We didn't, some of them got out of box. Then got out of order. You understand? So let me get Psalms 140 and 3 real quick. Psalms 140 and 3. All praise to the Most High, in honor of his only begotten beloved son. Long live the King, Yahoo. Psalms 140 and 3. It says, I'm going to start at 1. Deliver me, O Yahweh, from the evil man. Preserve me from the violent man, which imagine mischiefs in their heart continually, or they gather together for war. They have sharpened their tongues like a serpent. Adder's poison is under their lips. Selah. Go back to Romans. Romans 3, verse 13. Their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips. Romans 3 and 14. Whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Let's get Psalms 10 and 7. Let's see. You still using Torah? He all over the Torah, ain't he? I wonder what's going to be the excuse now. Oh, no, no, no. Some of it's true, but not all of it. Psalms. The book of Psalms, chapter 10. I'm going to read 5 through 7. His ways are always grievous. Thy judgments are far above out of his sight. As for all his enemies, he puffeth at them. He have said in his heart, I shall not be moved, for I shall never be in adversity. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places doth he murder the innocent. His eyes are privily set against the poor. Wow. Let's get on back to Romans 3. Romans 3 and 15. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Let's go to Proverbs 1 and 16. That's Proverbs 1 and 16, ain't it? Their feet are swift to shed blood. Proverbs chapter 1. I'm gonna read 15 and 16. My son, walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their path, for their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood. Man, this man is all through this Torah, ain't he? He all through this Torah, making his point. There is none that doeth good. We all under sin. Huh? So you can't pop up and say, well, that's a New Testament concept, because David was speaking about the same thing. Right? So now who's doing the selective scripture reading, or the selective scripture selection, should I say? How you gonna throw this on Paul like he making this up, but he's using the Torah to prove his very position and stance? So where are you at with it now? Okay. Romans 3, 16 and 17. It says, destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. Let's get Isaiah 59 and 7. Never let nobody play on your mind like that. And for you lukewarm messianics, y'all better get that together, man. I'm seeing a lot of brothers, especially on Facebook, man. I'm seeing a lot of brothers that claim they was down with the Messiah, and they falling back now. They falling way back. He done studied himself out the book, basically. You understand? And it's a shame. You can't, especially for you brothers that came into the truth and confess who Yahushua or Yahweh Shai is. Now, for you non-messianics that haven't, you understand there's still a chance. But for y'all that came in and took the toast and You know what I'm saying? The midi Yahushua is the Passover lamb and the lamb of the Almighty Yah. And then you turn your back and say he never existed. Woe unto you. Woe unto you. This is not a revolving door. You know what I'm saying? So it's time to get better. Get this thing together. Isaiah 59. I'm going to read verse 6 and 7. Their web shall not become garments, neither shall they cover themselves with their works. Their works are works of iniquity, and the act of violence is in their hands. Their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity, wasting and destruction are in their paths. The way of peace they know not. The way of peace they know not. And there is no judgment in their goings. They have made them crooked paths. Whosoever goeth therein shall not know peace. There is the way of peace they know not. Right? And a lot of this is admonition and rebuking to the nation of Israel. See, before we can even get on the world, we got to correct what's going on inward with us. We got to correct that. You know what I'm saying? And the prophets of old knew that. Isaiah, Jeremiah, they was telling our people, circumcise the foreskin of your heart. What good is your circumcision and you still hell-bent and rebelling against the Most High? Huh? So if Shaul was wrong, that means Jeremiah wrong. That means Isaiah wrong. That means David wrong. You see what I'm saying? So again, never let nobody have you take your eyes off the scripture and the belief in the Messiah. You feel me? These Negroes here couldn't deliver themselves. Salvation means deliverance. Yahshua. Huh? Deliverance, salvation in Hebrew. You understand? So wow, think about it. Who would want you to deny deliverance? Who would want you to deny rulership? Trip off that. That's what you're going to miss out on if you turn your back on the Messiah, man. This brotherhood is serious. You know what I'm saying? It ain't nothing to play with. And as we keep going through these scriptures, you're going to see the brother made his point with the Torah. So y'all go choke on the Torah then. Choke on the Torah, because your problem is with the Torah if your problem is with the letters of Paul, because that's what he dealt with. That's what he dealt with. The understanding he was coming with was coming out the Torah. It was just scriptures in the Torah that our people were choosing to duck, especially the learned ones, the elders and the priests. They was choosing to suppress. And willful suppression of evidence is a felony. Real talk. All right. So back to Romans 3 verse 18. It says, there is no fear of God before their eyes. Psalms 36:1. Let's get that. Is he making that up? Was he making up the rebellion and the hard head, stiff neck and rebellion of our people? Was he making that up? You say, well, yeah, he was making that up. Then you have to have a problem with David, Jeremiah, and all them. Because that's what Paul is quoting. All right, Psalms 36:1. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of the Most High before his eyes. I'm reading again. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of the Most High before his eyes. For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. What it say? That there is no fear of the Most High before his eyes. Back to Romans chapter 3 verse 18. There is no fear of the Most High before their eyes. Verse 19 through 20. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before the Most High. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. See, that's what I got a problem with right there. He just said, for by the works of the law, therefore by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. Is he making that up? You see, Paul, man, he just be going off, man. He double-minded, man. He double-minded in all his ways. You feel me? And I hear that false level of humility some of you brothers be trying to come with. You know what I'm saying? Like, you humble, brother. You ain't humble. Stop that. Stop that. Because if you was, you wouldn't be one line in these letters like that. I'm pretty sure ain't none of you Negroes one line Deuteronomy 28. Well, you combed Deuteronomy 28 with a fine-tooth comb to make sure that was us. You know you did. But when it come down to the entire scripture or, you know, any topic, why ain't you thoroughly studying that? How is you going to one-line the man and jump up out of there and laugh like you got a point off? Y'all boys look like some novices, man. No deeper than a footprint. Water puddle deep. That's about it. No, not deep at all. Right? We're going to call yourself a Torah knight. Man, please. Y'all getting handled around here. Romans chapter 3, right? Romans chapter 3. Read that again, verse 20. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. Is that true? Is that true? Let's read it again. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. Let's go to Psalms 143. Ooh-wee, y'all thought Paul made that up, huh? By the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. What's justification? Huh? Being declared righteous or being declared saved right then and there. By the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified. Did Paul make that up? Let's read Psalms 143:1. Hear my prayer, O Yahweh. Give ear to my supplications. In thy faithfulness answer me, and in thy righteousness. And enter not into judgment with thy servant, for in thy sight shall no man living be justified. Wow. And this is David, right? Didn't David keep Torah? For the most part, he was a transgressor as well, wasn't he? Yeah, he tripped. He tripped. If y'all know, a lot of y'all claiming David the Messiah, and we love to say that. You talking about David who had... Uriah the Hittite clipped and took his wife and boned her? That's your Messiah? David who numbered Israel, that's your Messiah? As great as the man was, he still had dirt on his jacket. He wasn't unblemished. But to show you how far these brothers will go, you'll say David is the Messiah. And we talk about David who took a man's wife and had her husband killed. Feel me? And had a baby with her. But that's your Messiah. See, y'all need to stop that, man. David fell short for a reason because he ain't the one who the Bible was prophesying about. Prophesying about one after David, one coming through David, but after. You know what I'm saying? Whose going forth is from everlasting. That's Micah chapter 5, Torah again, verse 1 through 2. Got to be born in Bethlehem, like David. Sure was the Messiah. New Testament, born in Bethlehem. You see what I'm saying? So David just said himself that, and enter not into judgment with thy servant, for in thy sight shall no man living be justified. For by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified, man. What is you talking about? David knew that. No flesh living to be justified because we all transgressors. It's only if the Lord decide to give you mercy. And as I said, give mercy. Notice I said give mercy, right? That's a present. That's a gift to give mercy. You see what I'm saying? Not that you had to work for it, but to give it. You understand? David understood no flesh living in your sight is even justified because we ought to transgress. So what Shaul was saying is not blasphemy. He was quoting the Torah. You see what I'm saying? Let's read. Let's get on back. And also, he said, for by the laws and knowledge of sin. Let's go to Exodus. I believe it's 20 and 20. Book of Exodus, chapter 20. I'm going to start at verse 18. Exodus chapter 20, verse 18. It says, and all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar off. And they said unto Moshe, speak thou with us. You speak with us, Moshe. Right? And we will hear. But let not the Most High speak with us, lest we die. So we wanted a mediator right out the gate. You feel me? You speak to us what he speak to you, and we'll listen to you. But if we hear the Most High, we gonna die. Let you know how powerful the Most High really is. All right? And right here. And Moses said unto the people, verse 20, and Moshe said unto the people, fear not, for the Most High has come to prove you, and that his fear may be before your faces, that ye sin not. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. You start back up at verse 1, you see that's when we receive the law. People got scared. Moses was like, the Lord came to try you, to make sure his fear was in you, so you wouldn't sin. So they got knowledge of the law. You know what I'm saying? For by the law is the knowledge of sin. So they got knowledge of the law, got scared, told Moses, like, look, whatever the Lord say, whatever the Most High say and tell you, you tell us, we going to listen. He said, look, don't get scared. Don't even fear. He came to prove you, to make sure that you didn't sin and that your fear was in him. So what Shaul was saying is not a lie. He's substantiating it with the Torah all the way through. All you got to do is have a heart to stand up and look at it for what it is. All right, let's get on back. Let's go back to this Romans, the third chapter. Romans 3. Bear with me for a sec. Romans 3. I believe I should be around verse 21. Romans 3. Read verse 20 again. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. That's Psalms 143, 1 and 2. David said that before Saul said it. Shaul said it. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. That's Exodus 20, 18 through 20. Okay. But now the righteousness of the Most High without the law is manifested or revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. So he was saying, so what is he basically saying? He was like, look, there's a righteousness of the Most High in the Torah, witnessed by the Torah, you feel me, that y'all choosing not to look at. And when it says without the law, it's talking about the administration and government of Aaron, Moses and them. You feel me? This is something before that. So he was like, look, so that's what he's calling Torah right there, a law. He's saying a righteousness without the law. You know what I'm saying? He's talking about the government and administration of Moses and Aaron, like the order of Aaron and all that, right? But there was righteousness in the earth before Moses got his commission. That's why he say being witnessed by the law and the prophets, because this ain't nothing new that Shaul making up. He gonna go right back into the Torah and show you what he's saying. So what he's saying, this faith, this righteousness without the law, but is witnessed by the law, it's the faith and belief in the Son of the Living Father. You know what I'm saying? And he's going to go back and show you how Abraham got down, even before he was circumcised, how he was rocking. You know what I'm saying? And that's what he mean being witnessed by the law and the prophets, because this righteousness of the Most High been in the earth. You know what I'm saying? And it was around before Moses got his commission on Mount Sinai. And that's where the Pharisees and them was at. They was only dealing with the Torah, starting with Moses, right? But the Messiah was dealing with the whole entire volume. He was going back to the beginning and dealing. And if you go back to the beginning and start dealing, pre-flood and even after flood on up to Abraham and all that, you feel me? You start seeing, well, hold on. There's a whole nother priesthood, different administrations. It was law on the earth before Moses even got it. What was going on? What was being said? All of them before Abraham wasn't even circumcised. You talking about righteous men like Shem, Enoch, Jared, Adam, Seth, Noah. The list goes on. You talking about a whole line of brothers that never got circumcised but praised the Most High and believed them. You feel me? So how was they deemed righteous? How was any of them deemed righteous before Moses? See, brothers want the Torah to start at Moses on Mount Sinai when the Torah starts in Genesis. You feel me? Before Moses was even born. That's what it means being witness, a righteousness without the law, the righteousness of God without the law, but being witnessed by the law and the prophets is being revealed. Why? Because this righteousness of God was around before Moses got his commission. It ain't hard to understand. Verse 22, even the righteousness of the Most High, which is by faith, belief, strong conviction, of Yahushua the Messiah, Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. Huh? We talking about what's no difference, what? In the spirit. It ain't none. How you gauge that? If in the spirit they got the belief. No, man, that's an A-rap, man. No, man. And look, if they want to align themselves with the Heavenly Father, your job is to show them how. You supposed to be the light. The light bearer. You know what I'm saying? Ones that bring the light to the rest of the nations, to the dark world. You understand? So you got to get out your feelings. This is not about your curriculum. It's about what does say of the scripture. It did take yourself about this thing. Trip off this. Verse 23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of Yah. Is that not true? Then we just read even David saying, hey, in your sight, no man living to be justified. We all done tripped. Their throat is an open sepulcher. Evil is in their midst. Their feet are swift to run to mischief. Hands swift to shed blood. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. So when he say right here, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of Yah, was he lying? That's the truth. Verse 24, it said, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in the Messiah, HaMashiach Yahawashah, Christ, whom the Most High have set forth to be a propitiation and atonement through faith or belief in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. For the remissions of sins that are past. Because even in the olden days during Moses, didn't we have to have faith that the lamb, that the blood of the lamb, then we have to have faith and put that on the door so that the death angel would pass over or have a forbearance, pass over and wouldn't bring judgment. You feel me? So you say, oh, no, man, see right there in his blood. But if you was in ancient Egypt, you would have to kill you a lamb, put your hands on the lamb, the whole congregation, kill the lamb, take the blood and put it on the doorpost. So the Messiah or the Most High could pass over your crimes or give you a forbearance. You know what I'm saying? So having blood for atonement, that's the majority of the law. You feel me? Let you know that all things about the law purged with blood. Almost all things are purged with blood. That's Old Testament, though. Read the book of Leviticus. All right. Verse 26. To declare, I say, at this time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believed in Yahushua, Yahawashah. Where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what Torah or by what law? Of works? Nay, by the law of faith. So boasting is excluded. Ain't no bragging. Because you know good and well you should be dead. You done heard the truth, you know what I'm saying, which is the faith, the spiritual circumcision, the circumcision of your heart. Now you're ready to be an obedient servant and work and do whatever the Most High is saying. But you got to get the faith first. You got to get the faith first, right? And it says, boasting is dead. Boasting is dead. Why? Because you know you should have been dead. Don't nobody come out of death row bragging and boasting. If he get a presidential pardon, he'll come out, yeah, nigga, shit, I told you. They got me messed up. He come out head down, humble, so thankful. You feel me? So if you got faith and true belief, what is you boasting about? But you know what could allow you to boast? Out of cup works. So you can look like you righteous to everybody else. Yeah. 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 That will cause a man to boast because people lust to be seen a certain way. People lust to have power. You know what I'm saying? God forbid that don't nobody like you. Say you stank, you're ugly. You know what I'm saying? We hate the fact that the world don't receive us. Hate it, right? Right here is Romans 3:28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified, declared righteous by faith without the deeds of the law. And, oh, my God, what are you saying? What are you saying? Well, why did the Most High pardon David? David got justified, a pardon of his iniquity. Why did the Lord do that? Right? Because the deed, what he did against the Torah, he should have been put to death. Or why was Abraham declared righteous? When the Most High told him to go out there and count them stars. If you can tell the stars, you can be able to tell your seed. How much your seed. That's how abundant your seed going to be. He said Abraham believed him and it counted to him for righteousness. Abraham had faith in what the Lord promised. and he counted to him for righteousness. Now, Abraham was uncircumcised when that happened. He wasn't circumcised in Genesis, the 17th chapter. So what Paul's saying is true. He ain't lying to you. And he gonna, as we keep reading, we're going to get the examples to show exactly what this is saying, right? It's a 29. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. It's another topic. You know, stay focused. Seeing it is one power which shall justify the circumcision by faith and uncircumcision through faith. Do we then make void the law through faith? Yah forbid. Yea, we established the law. So that kill you talking about Paul was saying be lawless. He's saying being we got to be justified. Faith is the key to being justified regardless. Right. Being that faith is on the table. Do we void out the law? Oh, no. God forbid. Yah forbid. We establish the law. So being that you got faith, you supposed to establish the commands of the Most High. Why? Because you get faith. Huh? Your belief declares you justified. You know what I'm saying? Now you're ready to work. Now you're ready to establish the law because you got full belief. Now, somebody can, you know, claim they acting or living by the law, but really not believe it, man. It's similar to children. You understand? Like children go to church with their parents or go wherever their parents tell them to go, whatever. But they could possibly not really believe what it is you're talking until they get tried themselves and their faith get put on the line. You understand? Let's get into this Romans 4. We got a couple more scriptures and we done. I just wanted to show how sloppy these men are claiming that they can pick Paul apart. Paul's a scholar, man. Scholar, the very level they still trying to be on. I don't care what non-Messianic Hebrew you know. How much he claims he's well-versed in the Ibrit and, you feel me, Lashawan, Kwadat, whatever non-Messianic bro you claim you know, they not on his level carnally. They're not even on his level before the Messiah revealed himself to him on the road to Damascus. You understand? And if you really want to pick him apart, you got to read the whole thing, man. Once you read the whole thing, it ain't no picking him apart. He's like, oh, he justifying what he's saying with the Torah. And these men call themselves Torah Knights. Boy, y'all boys are Torah pups. Y'all little boys, man. Y'all get handled around here with these scriptures. I got little brothers that are, man, handle y'all in seconds. It wouldn't even be funny. You know what I'm saying? But this is a message, a sincere message, hoping somebody on that platform gets some understanding and come up out of that dark mindset, man. Come up out of that dark mindset because it's going to get us destroyed by the Heavenly Father. Yahawashah was sent by Yah, Yahawah, to be the anointed Savior. He's the Most High's anointed Savior. Huh? The way back to the Father. You feel me? And everybody going to have to bow their head in subjection. He's the high priest after the order of Melchizedek. The heavenly priesthood. Everybody going to have to get down and bow down to what it is. All right? This is Romans 4. A couple more, we're going to get about here. This is Romans 4. I'm going to read verse 1 through 3. So what shall we say? What shall we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, have found? Remember, he just asked, do we void the law? Because faith is needed to justify you. But being that faith is needed, the question going to come up. Well, if all I need is faith, do I void the law out then? What do you say? No, God forbid, establish the law. So where you at now? He's just saying have full faith and belief, which is spiritual circumcision, then establish the law. You have to believe it first to be sealed, to be justified. Now you're ready to work. He didn't say void the law out. He said establish it. Huh? But if y'all kept reading, you feel me, you would have got that understanding. Romans 4 and 1. What shall we say then that Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, have found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he had whereof to glory, but not before the Most High. For what saith the scripture? Abraham believed the Most High, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. Let's go read that, Genesis 15. Let's see if Paul lying. Shaul lying. Let's see. Genesis 15. All praises to the Most High and honor and glory of his only begotten beloved son, Yahushua Mashiach, who's currently sitting at his right hand. Long live the king. Genesis 15. Let's see if he, let's see. Scriptures, didn't the scriptures say Abraham believed the Most High and he deemed him righteous for it? Excuse me, y'all. Genesis 15. Genesis 15 and 1. After these things, the word of Yahweh came unto Abram in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward." The shield of Abraham is the shield of David. Same thing, which is the Most High. The shield of faith. You understand? So it ain't two triangles or what people call a hexagram. That's not David's shield. David's shield is the full faith and belief in the Most High. All right, just like he just told Abram, "I'm your shield and exceeding great reward." And Abram said, "Yahweh, Elohim, what would thou give me, seeing I go childless? And the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus." And Abram said, "Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born of my house is mine heir." Behold, the word of Yahweh came unto him, saying, "This shall not be thine heir. This shall not be thine heir. But he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir." He brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Most High, and he counted it to him for righteousness. You see that? Most High promised him his seed was going to be many when he was an old man and have one seed. Old man, 90s, in his 90s, 80s, 90s, didn't have one seed. And the Most High said, "Man, tell the stars, if you can number them, that's how numerous your seed going to be." Abraham said, "Oh, Lord, see, there you go again. Oh, Lord, you tripping. Oh, I still got to wait." Abraham ain't bad. He believed in the Most High, and the Most High said, "You're righteous for that." So Abraham's faith is what justified him to be called righteous, or declared him to be righteous in the eyes of the Most High. His belief. Now that's Torah, ain't it? Ain't Genesis 15 Torah? All right, and being it is Torah, why is it so much he coming on Paul when all he doing is quoting the Torah? You know what the problem is? He quoting the parts of the Torah that you niggas is scared of. Because it destroys your whole doctrine. You understand? And that's the problem. Men need to repent. Feel me? You've been slandering brothers, calling brothers idolaters, calling Paul, calling his letters little old letters. I know certain men done called him a female dog. You understand? Called the man Pauline. And all he doing from what we reading thus far, he's just quoting scripture. He's just quoting scripture. Right, the scriptures you scared to deal with. So you ain't no Torah knight. Y'all Torah pups, man. You know what I'm saying? Y'all swords ain't out nowhere. Y'all ain't cutting nothing, man. Stop it. You dig? That was an embarrassment. If y'all was some prosecutors, man, y'all would be fired. That was an embarrassment. I'm like, man, these brothers left all this evidence on the field. Y'all left all this on the table. Nobody addressed the evidence. Oh, man, I smell a snake, right? It said right here, verse 4. Now to him, this is Romans 4 and 4. Now to him that worketh is the reward, not reckoned of grace, but of debt. True. So if somebody giving you something, right, say you get a check cut, right, that's either a loan or a grant. Now, if you got to pay it back, that means you got to go to work. That means that's actually a debt you got. You know it got interest on it. But a grant is a gift. You ain't got to give that back. So what he's saying, if you thinking you can work to be justified, that means you in debt. That you ain't justification and being declared righteous, you feel me, having your iniquity pardoned is a gift. It ain't nothing you can work for or work to. It's a gift given. You know what I'm saying? Now you can get your name blotted out. You can get your name blotted out because you didn't continue on the path. You didn't do righteous works. You know what I'm saying? But you can't work your way to faith. You got to believe it first. You got to have faith in it first. You got to be justified through your righteous faith first. Then you're ready to work. then you're ready to handle your business. You know what I'm saying? Because if not, it's the other way around. It's just a hypocrisy at its highest level, which is out of cup Israelites thinking they're going to be justified because they circumcised on the eighth day and got on garments and phylacteries and was raised under some great rabbi master teacher. He think he guaranteed to get in. Well, that ain't the case. That ain't the case at all. You know what I'm saying? All right. So right here is Romans 4:5. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Oh, it says, see, one of you clowns pulled this verse right here and jumped about the frying pan quick. He dared not keep reading the very next verse, verse 6. Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom the Most High imputed righteousness without works. Oh, really? Saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Most High will not impute sin. So, in other words, the Most High pardon your iniquity and forgive you. And look, he was like, David was talking about the Lord doing that without works back in Psalms. So how was y'all throwing daggers at Paul or Shaul when he quoting David, who most you Negroes claim is y'all Messiah? Let's get into it. Let's go to Psalms 32, 1 through 2. Hold your spot right there in Romans 4. And we almost done. Psalms 32, 1 through 2. Easy work, man. Easy work. Y'all be ready to defend this word. You lukewarm messianics, y'all better get some act right, man. I ain't never been so embarrassed in my life. I'm like, man, look, most of y'all famous. Y'all seek these high seats of eminence and preeminence. Being all on Sarnetta's couch and trying to be, you know, the top camp out here. We need to sit back and watch. Okay, well, this brother claim he messianic. Let's see if he can handle his business. If he can defend the throne. You feel me? You let characters like Zion, Lex, and all them just run through y'all, man. I'm like, oh my God, I can't even believe this. Can't even believe it. But you know why? Because you really don't believe what it is you got in your hand. The faith ain't there. You know what I'm saying? Even Zion Lex told y'all boys, it say it's a virgin birth in Hebrew and in English. Huh? I asked y'all if y'all believed all y'all said no. Then he said, well, we know you don't believe that, but why is it in your text? He is in there. You can't get around it. It's in there. But y'all don't want to deal. Y'all don't want to address what this really about. You understand? So you should let some non-messianics sit here and confound you, brothers. I'm like, oh my. But see, they know who to go deal with. You know what I'm saying? They tie them out for the funnies, man. Souls is on the line. Psalm 32, 1 and 2. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Most High imputeth not iniquity. And whose spirit there is no guile. All right? Let's go back to Romans then. What is the Most High pardon iniquity for? Huh? Because you hurried up and kept 100 more Sabbaths? What is he pardon iniquity for? Huh? Because he decides to show mercy. Mercy, grace, salvation. Huh? Being pardoned for your iniquity is a gift. Huh? It ain't nothing. That you can work toward. You feel me? It's because the Most High decided to give it. Now, once you get it, you need to practice righteous works, man. You dig? And act like you're thankful for being let off death row. Because we were good as dead. And you all know what I mean by practicing righteous works. Best of your ability. Keep these commandments of the Heavenly Father, man. Be sincere. Serve him with all your heart, mind, body, and soul. And love your neighbors yourself. You understand? And believe in the flawless testimony of his only begotten son. You understand? Righteous works. You understand? So right here, verse 9. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. So the questions say, okay, well, if the fact the Most High forgives some sins, you dig, and pardon iniquity, the question was, does that only happen to the circumcision and not the uncircumcision? And he reminds you, now remember, we just said Abraham was reckoned righteous, right? We just read that. His faith would deem him righteous. So the question is, since we dialoguing, right? The fact that the Lord decided to pardon iniquity, is that blessing only for the circumcision? That's a good question. Is it only for the circumcision, or is it for the circumcision and uncircumcision? And remember, we just said Abraham was reckoned and deemed righteous. All right, let's read. It says right here, it says, how was it then reckoned when he was in circumcision or in uncircumcision? Not in circumcision, but in uncircumcision. In other words, when he told him to go count the stars, and he said, that's how many your seed going to be. And it said Abraham believed in the Most High, and he counted it to him for righteousness. For y'all that don't know, Abraham was uncircumcised at that time in the flesh. That was Genesis 15. He didn't get circumcised in Genesis, the 17th chapter. So, all right, let's deal. Because our father Abraham was justified because he had belief in what the Lord promised him. Right? And the Most High deemed him righteous, declared him righteous. And Abraham didn't even have, he wasn't even circumcised yet. So, an uncircumcised person can be declared righteous through belief, through faith in what the Lord promises. Wow. If you was to say, no, that can't happen, then how was it able to happen to Abraham? That's the question. Because Abraham was uncircumcised when the Most High declared him righteous in Genesis 15, because he believed in the promise that the Most High told him he was going to have many seeds when he didn't have one. So if you firing off at Paul, you firing off at Abraham and David. Trip off that. Y'all cut your own throats, man. That's what happened. You cutting your own throat. It says, and he received the sign of circumcision. And he received the sign of circumcision. Well, I'm at right there, 10 through 17. Okay. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal. The sign of circumcision. A seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet being uncircumcised. You see that? So he got circumcised because faith in what the Lord promises circumcises you. It seals you. Faith in what he promised is spiritual circumcision. It's circumcision of the heart. It seals you. Abraham received that while he was uncircumcised. Now that's Torah. That's Torah. And these are parts of the Torah that Shaul was bringing out that, you know, those that's overzealous, they were ready to kill brothers behind all that. But these scriptures not going nowhere because you and your feelings. It's the truth. All right. Now trip off this. It says, and he received the sign. He received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe, that he might be the father of all them that have faith. All of them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. Trip off that. Wow. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. That's a Torah fact. I know brothers that don't want to deal with that. I know there's some brothers I got respect, but they do not want to deal with that. But it's the truth. Abraham wasn't circumcised for the first, 85 years of his life? Is that not true? Is it not true? Abraham wasn't circumcised for the first probably 85 years of his life. So how was he deemed righteous before then? And you out here pumping, lest you circumcise, nigga, you ain't getting into that kingdom. Physically, man, we go into showing how exactly Abraham actually was reckoned righteous while he was in his uncircumcision. And it was his belief and faith. So if we follow the righteous steps of Abraham and have righteous faith and belief, guess what? You're justified. And at that point, you're ready to do the work. So when the Lord told me, hey, yeah, man, circumcised, no problem. Hey, man, offer up your son, no problem. Hey, man, go do this, no problem. Why? Because he truly believed. Even when he was going to sacrifice Isaac, Abraham had in his mind the Most High God must gonna give him back to him. He's the promise. So he got to give him back to him. Even if he get laid down, he gonna give him back. You see, that's that faith, that unwavering faith. That's that belief that seals you. Nobody telling you ain't got to keep commandments. Of course, keep the commandments. Once you got that type of faith, whatever the Lord commands, you ready to go. You lockstep with it. You a willing servant at that point. So ain't nobody saying you ain't got to keep the commandments, but you got to have that faith and belief first. And faith come by the hearing of the word. Right? And then somebody got to be sent to speak the word to you. So you can have the faith that come by hearing the word of the Most High. So you can be justified because you believe the truth. Now you a willing servant. Lord, what you need me to do? I'm ready to rock. I'm ready to rock. Let's get it done. But that's the order behind it. You know what I'm saying? You see these brothers grossly chopped up Paul's letters. And it says right here, verse 13, for the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Ain't that true? It wasn't through. It was through him believing what the Most High promised him. Once he believed what the Most High promised him, he was deemed righteous. He was justified. You know what I'm saying? So he was promised the kingdom. And it was all based off of belief. It wasn't based off because he, you know what I'm saying, kept this many Sabbaths. It wasn't based off because he did all this. It was based off against hope. He believed in hope. As an old man, never had no seed, believed that he was going to have many seeds. You know what I'm saying? And Lord said, you righteous for that. So we seen that's Torah concept. You know what I'm saying? And again, everybody saying don't circumcise your son on the eighth day. You understand? But your son going to have to get the spiritual circumcision for him to get into the kingdom. The Lord ain't tripping. Like he even got circumcised. Like take down your drawers. Let me see. You got circumcised? Oh, let him in. Nah, that's going to be if you really believe this truth, man. If you really believe what this thing is. Right here, verse 14. It says, for if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect. Huh? And notice he's going into Moses and Aaron's administration, the order of Aaron. You feel me? If they which are of the law, trip off there, for if they which are of the law be heirs, faith, the belief that Abraham had, is made void, and the promise made of none effect. Because the law worketh the wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. That's true. But so certain things you calling sin ain't sin. Where no law is, there is no transgression. 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace. All these are gifts. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed. Not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even Yah, who quickened the dead and calleth those things which be not, as though they were. And he did, that's in Genesis 17. What's that? Genesis 17 and 5, made you a father of many nations. Huh? Made you a father of many nations. Verse 18. Who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. That's Genesis 15 and 5 through 6. See that? Quoting scripture the whole way through. What about this? And being not weak in faith. So when the Lord promised it to Abraham, he wasn't weak. He didn't stagger at it. He didn't doubt. Lord, I don't know. Soon the Lord promised to him, he believed it. Right? And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. You'd have thought, man, this is about to be a miracle. Menopause in reverse. Huh? Skin hanging off my back. I'm old. And the Lord just told me I'm about to have me a son. And now then through him, I'm going to have many seeds. Lord believed it. Didn't stagger at it. Lord, I don't know. See, last time he ain't show up for me. We seeing what pleases the Most High is faith. Hebrews the 11th chapter. Without faith, you can't please him. You got to first believe. And once you believe and justify it, now you're ready to do the work of the Lord, man. But you got to believe it first, right? And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of Yah through unbelief. Unbelief. He ain't stagger it. He ain't doubt. Right? But was strong in faith, giving glory to the Most High, and being fully persuaded that what he promised, he was able to perform. See, fully persuaded. But the Lord told me, I know he gonna perform it. I don't care who think it's a lie. I don't care who laughing. Huh? It's to the casket drop. He say, it say, read again, and being 21, and being fully persuaded that he, that what he had promised, he was able also to perform, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. For being fully persuaded and knowing what the Most High promised he gonna do, it'll be counted to you for righteousness. You understand that? Now, it was not written, for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but for us also to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Yahushua, our master, from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. You see that? I'm going to get Genesis 26, 4 through 5 and get up out of there showing you that Abraham kept the commandments. So we ain't never saying you got to keep the commandments, but get the faith, get the full belief. Don't stagger at the promise so you can be justified. You know what I'm saying? If you just thinking, well, you know, I got my garment on today. I wore my garment every day. I got my fringes hanging out. I know I'm going to be justified. I know I'm going to try my best to keep the laws. But you really don't believe. All right? I'm tired of praying. Now you're going to pray to the Most High, but you don't believe he can get done what it is he promised. All right? Genesis 26, for y'all to think that he was promoting being lawless. Abraham kept the commandments. Genesis 26, verse 4 and 5. This is the Lord talking to Isaac. And I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, and will give unto thy seed all these countries. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because that Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. So faith without works is dead, no doubt, but it's the faith you get the justification, you believe, then you're ready to work. Faith come by hearing the word. You got to hear the word from somebody sent by the Most High. You believe, you don't stagger at it, you don't doubt it, and that unlock the miracles within your life like it did for our forefather Abraham. You're justified, now you're ready to work to keep the charge of the Heavenly Father. You understand? So shots fired at the guys that call themselves the Torah Knights, y'all Torah pups. Y'all need to go back to the drawing board. Any of you lukewarm non-messianics out here that don't really believe in the whole New Testament, shut down. You're not qualified to teach. You Torah Knights, shut down. You're not qualified to teach. Y'all need to go back to the drawing board with that. If you're out here worshiping man like so-called General Yohanna or the so-called discomforter, shut down. You're not qualified to teach. You understand? This thing is dead real out here, and the Most High about to really start sifting. You understand? So with that being said, all praises to the Most High, Yahweh, in the name of his only begotten beloved son, Yahweh Shah Mashiach. Long live the King. Shalom.